Hallo und herzlich willkommen zurück zu einer weiteren Folge The Song of Saya. Und wir haben in der letzten Folge ja durch die Dokumente von Dr. Ogai erfahren, wie Saya quasi erschaffen wurde, ist falsch. Wie Saya zu einem Wesen geworden ist, nenne ich es jetzt mal. Gut. Und ja, Koji ist jetzt wahrscheinlich. Koji ist jetzt wahrscheinlich auf dem Weg zum. Nach Tokio, beziehungsweise ist wahrscheinlich schon in Tokio, wenn ich. Um halt Fuminashi zu stellen. Und ja, mal sehen, was das da jetzt dann alles wird. Es entwickelt sich immer mehr und mehr Richtung Finale. Koji pulls up 2 blocks away from the Sakisaka house and stares at the silent building. In the bright light of morning, the house seems shrouded in a dark miasma, like a black hole torn out of the landscape. It is just a figment of Koji's imagination. Also, is it just a figment of Koji's imagination? Hey, Figment! Sorry. Wenn ich das Wort Figment höre bzw. lese, dann muss ich immer an einen gewissen, ja, lilanen Drachen denken, welcher von Disney kommt. Figment of Imagination. Das Ding hat sogar ein eigenes Lied. One Little Spark. Ehrlich, dieses Wesen ist geil. Kann ich nur empfehlen. Kann man sich mal mit beschäftigen, mit Figment. Und auch das Lied ist auch geil. Es ist halt ein bisschen Brain. Nee, Brain AFK kann man eigentlich nicht sagen. Ich sag mal so, einige würden wahrscheinlich einen Nervenzusammenbruch kriegen, weil denen das Lied zu sehr auf die Nerven gehen könnte. Beziehungsweise dieses Wesen. Ich mag's, ich find's knuffig. Ich hab's sogar, als ich mit meinen Eltern in Florida war und wir in Disney World waren, habe ich davon sogar ein Plüschtier gekauft, weil ich das Viech so geil fand. Aber egal, ich schweife wieder ab. Is it just a figment of Koji's imagination? Every window is closed, offering no glimpse of the inside. Koji has no way of knowing whether Fuminori is home. A pedestrian walks his dog down the street, glancing back at Koji through the windshield after he passes by. Koji isn't surprised by the attention. He hasn't bathed or changed clothes since spending the night buried in mud. So he must look like a vagrant even inside his car. When he looks into the rearview mirror, he sees the haggard visage of a man with one foot in the grave staring back at him. Okay, yeah. Ich glaube, ich habe mich wiedergefunden. It's hard to believe that the tired, unshaven face is really his. If he stays here for too long, someone might report him to the police. He would be better pull himself together and get moving. He drives slowly up to the front of Fuminori's house, quickly checks to make sure no one is around and gets out of the car. Anyone who might be in the house probably heard the sound of the engine, but there's no point in worrying about that now. Koji walks swiftly through the gate and yeah, to the front door. He puts his hands on the doorknob for going the bell. The time for such pleasantries has passed. The door is unlocked and the knob turns easily in his hand. He puts his ear to the door and listens for any signs of life. So he's acting like a thief. He realizes with some shame, but that is the least of his worries now. No sound from within. After checking the street again to make sure no one is looking, he quickly opens the door and disappears inside. And in an indescribable stink immediately assaults his nostrils. He is already prepared for anything. However, rather than discourage him, the stench only sharpens his caution to a razor's edge. He has crossed his threshold many times in the past, and his memories of days spent here are still bright. So why does he feel the same ominous blood chilling aura that permeated Uga's home and cabin? Anger and sorrow, says Koji Sad, as though a dear friend's grave has been defiled. Koji doesn't remove his shoes before entering. He knows why he's here, and it's not to be polite. Every storm shutter is closed, filling the house with gloom, and he can see nothing but pitch black darkness through the open doors in the hallway. He should have brought his flashlight from the car, he thinks ruefully, and then remembers that he dropped the light when Fuminori attacked him. It's still lying in the backyard of the cabin in Tochigi. The house might be empty then again. It might not. Each particle of the air seems charged with silent menace. Is this enemy lurking somewhere in the darkness? It's not hard to imagine Fuminori waiting for a chance to take him by surprise and finish what the whale failed to. Koji walks down the first floor hallway, then climbs the stairs and checks the second floor too. He moves slowly and carefully, keeping his senses sharp, but feels nothing watching him from the shadows. After completing his round safely, he is convinced that the house is empty. He suddenly realizes that his right hand is touching the cold steel of the gun in his pocket. Did he intend to draw the weapon upon encountering Fuminori? Now that Koji thinks about it, his own action seems mysterious to him. What is he planning to do when he meets Fuminori? Will he lay into him with curses and epithets? Ich glaube nicht, dass das sonderlich viel bringen würde. Will he force him to turn himself in, or will he? Koji shakes his head. This isn't the time for such hopeless questions. If he keeps thinking, he will stop moving. If he stops moving, fear will paralyze him forever. His only choice is to keep marching on. He has to close the distance to his prey. In any case, Fuminori isn't home. What form the reunion takes will probably be decided at the moment of the meeting. All Koji has to do is not hesitate when the time comes. Still, why does the Hulich house smell like stagnant water? It has been 3 months since Fuminori distanced himself from his friends. Just what kind of life has he been leading all this time? Koji enters the living room and feels along the wall for the light switch. The moment he flips it on, the answer to his questions is revealed. How far has Fuminori gone? Koji realizes that this is the first time he has encountered Fuminori's insanity in visible form. From the dust piled in the corners of the room, it is clear that the paint was not applied recently. How many nights has Fuminori spent surrounded by this maddening array of color? Why didn't Koji realize that something was wrong before it got this bad? Was he deaf to the dying screams of Fuminori's sanity? Was their friendship really so worthless? As he stands petrified in the unfamiliar living room, Koji directs his anger entirely at himself. If he could, he would like nothing more than to apologize to Fuminori for failing to help him through his suffering. Koji feels that he might have been able to save his friend. Perhaps he is arrogant to think so, but if so, it is arrogance born of kindness. Koji passes through the living room and opens the sliding door that leads to the kitchen. When he enters, he finds that the most disturbing of the house many chances is stronger here. Blood. The room is redolent with the smell of countless layers of blood grown stale over time. He peers into the well-used sink. Around the rim, he sees faint brownish red blood spots that water alone couldn't rinse off. Even more obvious are the stains on the dish rack. Such stains are proof that the rack has been used and reused countless times. But what could it have been used on to make it that sickening burgundy color? Koji stares at the refrigerator next to the counter, so it were a monster waiting to swallow him whole. Ich weiß nicht, ich denke, du solltest lieber nicht den Kühlschrank bzw. die Tiefkühltruhe öffnen. Ich weiß nicht, ob das so eine kluge Idee ist. Ich weiß auch nicht, inwiefern vielleicht Teile von Omi da noch drin sind, die du vielleicht wiedererkennen könntest, Junge. He stands motionless until he is able to work up the courage simply to touch it. Then he steals himself, grabs a thick hand and opens the door. Dumme Idee. würde ich sagen. First he will check the freezer, then the refrigerator. Ich weiß nicht, ob ich da unbedingt Bilder von sehen möchte, falls das gleich gezeigt wird. The freezer is packed with frozen meat of varying shapes and sizes. As each piece is wrapped tightly and frosted over plastic, you can't tell what kind of meat it is. The meat in the refrigerator, however, has already been thawed for consumption. Oh, nett. Na, lecker. For a while he can only stare in disbelief at the five fingers beckoning to him from the back of the contemplat. They are the long slender fingers of a woman, their bluest tingy giving them the appearance of waxworks. Coach is unable to remember what Otzi's hands looked like, even though he has kissed her fingers countless times. When he finishes crying after his conversation with Fuminori, Coach promised himself that he would not cry again, and in fact he does not. He regrets his decision, however. He indulged himself too early. He should have saved his soothing tears for this moment. For now, he knows that truly nothing is sacred. At last, his doubts about Fumino have been utterly obliterated. Hat jetzt irgendwie erkannt? Coach pulls Urgas revolver out of his pocket and wraps his hand around its grip like he would a charm. Its definite presence, its promise of merciful annihilation, is the only thing keeping his sanity intact. He will surely use it to kill Sakisaka Fuminori, not for revenge, not for justice, but to make this world once more a place governed by reason. With that purpose alone, he must eliminate the anomaly. He breathes deep, exhales, then lifts his hand before his face and stares at his spread fingers. Alright, he's not shaking. He's prepared to face his new objective. Okay. Koji sticks the revolver back into his pocket and pulls out his phone. Ooh. Open save. Ich mach mal das. Also ich sag mal so, wenn ich wollen würde, dass er gewinnt, dann würde ich, dass Fuminori gewinnt, dann würde ich sagen, er würde Fuminori anrufen. Wenn ich wollen würde, dass Fuminori verliert und das Coach gewinnt, dann würde ich wahrscheinlich Ryoko anrufen. Aber ich gehe nicht danach, wer irgendwie gewinnen oder verlieren soll. Sondern ich gehe danach, was ich einfach aus seiner Sicht für die logische Entscheidung empfinde in der Situation. Und das wäre, dass er Ryoko anruft. The ringing of her cell phone interrupts Ryoko's labors. When she sees that the caller is Tonoko Kochi, she unwittingly breathes a sigh of relief. This is Tambo, what is it? Er ist jetzt von Minoris Haus. Even over the phone, Ryoko can hear the change in Kochi's tone. His is the dull, flat voice of someone who has had all the energy beaten out of him. For Minori has murdered people. He has killed too many people to count, and he is eating them. His first steps into Ryoko's world have already brought him face to face with something particularly gruesome. In consideration of his probable state of mind, he says to say nothing. Omi is dead, Kochi continues. Tsukuba too, probably. Doctor, I was wrong. The fact that you are still alive to make this call means you haven't made a fatal mistake yet, Ryoko says, praising Kochi in her own way. Whether he is comforted or not is up to him. Anyway, don't screw up this time. Do nothing until I return. What we're dealing with here isn't going down easy. With her understanding of Saya depending by the hour, Ryoko is able to make this declaration with new confidence. Fuminori already knows I'm alive. I didn't tell him who rescued me, but he's definitely on guard. I see. Coach's actions were rushed, but there's no point regretting them now. The more proactive approach would be to to use the pressure that he has placed on Fuminori. Yoko's involvement is still a secret that makes her a wild card. Depending on how she plays it, this adventure could be decisive. Have you found anything? Not enough yet, Yoko answers, glancing sadly as the loose leaf page is still scattered across the table. Let's see, I will wrap this up by evening and return to Tokyo around midnight. You stay out of trouble until then, got it? Yes. The lack of emotion in Koji's voice is actually reassuring to Yoko. He's a machine now, able to do whatever it takes to accomplish a single goal, the extermination of Sakisaka Fuminori. He is even willing to accept help from Yoko, whose principles hardly mesh with his. A praiseworthy change indeed. After Yoko hangs up, she gloomily counts the stack of loose leaves that still needs to be restored. There's no time left. She will only be able to get the general picture. If she has to go into battle with only fragmentary knowledge, then there's one thing that she absolutely must discover. Oga's biological reports, which should contain information on the strengths and weaknesses of the organism called Saya. All she can do now is pray for luck as she delves back into the mountains of paper. Today was the first time I've driven since my accident last summer. The proposition was always too dangerous to consider, given my inability to recognize roads and cars. Things have changed, however. In the 3 months, I've adapted to my condition. I know what cars and pedestrians look like now, and even though I can't exactly see colors, I've learned to decipher lights and turn signals. I still can't read street signs, of course. Nevertheless, I managed to make it safely to our destination with Saya and Yo in the backseat. It was Saya who came up with the idea for our new hideout, an abandoned building she has discovered while living with Dr. Ogai. In these hilly suburban residential areas, it's not hard to find thick patches of undeveloped forest just off the beaten path. Saya's old playground is located in one such secluded area, unaffected by the flow of everyday life. It used to be a privately operated sanatorium hidden among the silent trees. After the owners went bankrupt, it remained unsold and was eventually forgotten. After I left Saya and Yo at the hideout, I returned to town to make some preparations. Now I'm finally back at our new refuge. I liked this ruin from the moment I saw it. Mountains of construction materials and garbage litter in the front yard, forming a serviceable barricade. This place looks even less likely to receive unwanted attention than our house. Since my brain sees humans as revolting monsters, places they've been tend to sting us seem covered in filthy slime. Ruins like these, long empty or lives, are the places I find most restful. Tadaima. I'm back. I call out to let them know I'm not a stranger. Then I go down to the basement where they are hiding. Welcome back. Were you okay with the car? It was no problem at all. I figured out how to tell which roads are one way. As long as I keep my speed down, there's nothing to worry about. So how are things here? I took a look around, as though there's no sign that anyone's been here since I found this place. It's safe. I see. Let's hope it stays that way. I'm a little worried that this abandoned building could become a hangout for biker gangs and homeless people. It's probably because of all the trash piled up front. Most people won't get anywhere near that, don't you think? I guess. It doesn't bother me at all. I rather like it, in fact, but of course normal people would feel differently. So, how was your shopping? Did you find something good? I sure did. Ooh. Okay, an axe. I proudly unwrapped the weapon I just bought from the camping goods store. A 1 meter long wood axe, the biggest and sturdiest I could find. I like how this was right next to a sign saying that long knives are illegal. Seems like you could do way more damage with one of these. I grip the axe with both hands, testing its dependable weight, then swing it like a baseball bat. The deadly steel blade sweeps through the air right where a person's neck would be. Yo, who is sprawled out on the floor, flinches at the sound and curls herself into a ball. How sharp is it? Want to test it on Yo? Alter, what? Das ist doch krank. I don't think that's a good idea. I definitely wasn't expecting Saya to suggest anything so brutal. You don't need to worry. Her new body can heal pretty easily from cuts and such. Alter, nein! But I'm sure it will hurt. Oh yeah, I guess you're right. Alter, Saya, du bist echt bösartig. It must have slipped her mind completely. She smiles at the oblivious Yo as if to hide her embarrassment and says, but her screams are pretty adorable, don't you think? Boy, alter Schwede. Well, I just wouldn't feel right using an axe on a human. Really? Then what about Koji? That's easy. It should be obvious, but I guess that Saya still doesn't understand. I don't see him as human. I will have no trouble cutting him to pieces. That really makes a difference? Yeah, humans have a conscience, you see? What the fuck? No matter how much you hate someone, you can't help but think twice about killing them. And that's how I will win. Really? Saya seems awfully subdued. I guess she is concerned about what will happen when I have it out with Koji. He is bigger and stronger, so I might not have much chance against him in a straight up fight. But what's just slaying a monster to me is murder to him. This is big. He will definitely hesitate when it counts. Ich glaube nicht, dass er noch. I'm a little worried, Saya says softly, staring at the floor with unusual gravity. You can never be sure how someone will react. It's dangerous to rely on that. She raises her head and looks straight at me. Don't you think it would be better if I hunt him? I appreciate Saya's consideration, even though it could be interpreted as a lack of faith in me. She is still putting my safety above hers. Nevertheless, I can't accept her heartfelt suggestion. With your strength, you might be able to overpower a girl like you, but I think it would be hard for you to take down a guy. Ich glaube absolut nicht. The bitter memory of Saya's rape is still fresh in my mind. Saya falls silent for a moment, seeming to understand what I'm thinking, but then comes right back to stubbornly press her case. My first attack went fine, though. Most humans go glim as soon as they see me. It was the same in the hospital. You were the only one who could talk to me. I guess you have a point. Okay, I can't imagine it personally, but I suppose it's possible that Saya's appearance is shocking enough to make some lose their nerve. Susumi was able to gain the advantage because he had the same conditions as me, which let him see Saya as a cute girl. Fear doesn't necessarily make people weaker. However, depending on the situation, it can even send someone into a berserk rage and make him harder to put down. In other words, such a tactic would be the same sort of gamble that Saya's worried about. Alright, Saya, how about this? When I tell Saya the new plan that just popped into my head, her gloomy frown turns into a bright smile. That's perfect. You're so smart for me, Nori. Okay, Saya lenkt Fuminori ab, Saya lenkt Koji ab und Koji und Fuminori erschlägt Koji da von hinten oder andersrum, eins von beiden, oder stop. Oder nehmen sie Yo als Bait. Ach du Scheiße, it's not exactly a great plan, but I guess the fact that that it lessens the risk to me is enough to excite her. She is so easy to please, but that's part of what makes her so cute. So, when is Koji coming? I don't know, he will call sooner or later, and then I will lure him here and finish him. Koji will come, I know that he won't leave us alone. We could just keep running now that we have started, but I want to eliminate Koji as soon as possible. Therefore, when he contacts me, I intend to meet with him unless it's an obvious trap. We are finally going to get more human meat. Too bad it's just going to rot without a refrigerator. Why don't we use the trap other animals. It could be bait for stray cats or cows. That's too dangerous. If an animal gets away with the meat, someone might find it and wonder where it came from. Da hat er recht. Good point. Humans are extremely dangerous. And their filthy, stinking bodies make me sick just by being nearby. Ironically, however, nothing tastes better than the meat. I truly regret having to abandon our well-stocked fridge. The forest around here is full of animals. I don't think we will have any trouble finding food. We have three mouths to feed, are you sure? Leave it to me. I may not look like it, but I'm a pretty good hunter. I will be sure to keep us well fed. So, ich kann mir sehr gut vorstellen, dass ein sehr guter Jäger ist. Oder er gesagt, Predator, so kann man glaube ich sehr gut bezeichnen, diese Kreatur. Okay, looks like you're going to be the breadwinner of this family. Zaya giggles happily at my praise. Her fancy childish qualities of hers adorable. I wonder how long we were able to relax this time. Because of the casual way she says it, I almost miss the emptiness to which her question leads. Yeah. Saya's right, this won't last forever. No matter how safe the site it might seem, we will have to abandon it, eventually. The slightest mistake could put our life together in jeopardy. Just like when I failed to silence Koji. Some dumb kids might decide that this old ruin is a good place to test their courage. This land might be targeted for new development. In order to be together with Saya, I have chosen to live apart from society. We will never find lasting peace in this world. Teeming with humans? Okay. Not unless we can somehow escape from it. Think of it like going on a journey, just the two of us. I put Saya into my arms and fold my hands around her slender shoulder, then whisper, life is like a journey anyway. Nothing stays the same forever. The only difference is whether time passes, you by or sweeps you up in its flow. I guess you're right. Saya smiles softly, perhaps in resignation, perhaps in sadness. Either way, there's peace and contentment in her expression. But we will be together, so I'm not lonely. You are not lonely either, are you? No. I have no regrets. As long as I can hold Saya in my arms, I will gladly pay any price. And besides, she adds brightly, trying to cheer me up. One day, we won't have to hide anymore. I can promise you that. It sounds like a fairy tale, but for some reason, she seems absolutely certain. That day might be tomorrow, or might be far off in the future. Okay. It's my first time, so even I don't know when the sign will come. Okay, I'm a little scared. Okay, I have no idea what Saya's prophetic words mean, but this isn't the first time that she has said or done something mysterious. She has performed any number of miracles already. So there's hope for us too? Yeah, she says with a cheerful nod. It will be my last present to you, if we know. My first and final duty. Okay. What the fuck? Okay. Nein, ich wollte nicht Quicksave, ich wollte... Okay, interessant. Safe. Yup. Alright, safe files. Diese Prophezeiung könnte entweder darauf hindeuten, dass Saya mehr von ihrer Art gebären wird und die dann die Welt übernehmen. Oder dass halt die Wesen, die Saya erschaffen haben, zur Erde kommen und ja, die dann übernehmen. Interessant. Mal sehen, worauf das dann alles hinauslaufen wird. Aber naja, jetzt bedanke ich mich erstmal fürs Zuschauen und bis zum nächsten Mal. Ciao.